We have scientists sitting around the tables here at CERN that will not, you know, whose country will not sit around the table for political discussions. And so this is a very important message.
What is it like to be at the head of an organization like CERN?
Being Director General is a fantastic job. It's a privilege, of course, it's a honor, it's also a big responsibility. It's a very varied job that spans several issues, from scientific issues, mainly strategic, to technical decision, to budget, personnel, relation, international relations, relation with the member state countries and other countries, education, training, you know, overseeing the large spectrum of activities of the organization, which is a very, very rich one.
Is it easy to manage all those physicists?
Well, I'm a physicist myself, so of course I feel really at home. And what is very nice in this place is that it's always a teamwork. We also always work together, and we try to get different point of views around the table. And when I have a problem, I like to put it on the table, to deconstruct it, get the input of different people, even if at the end it's me who has to draw the conclusions.
The LHC is now on extended shutdown until early 2021. You've now got a decade or so's data. So are you happy with what the LHC has achieved in that time?
Of course, we are extremely, extremely happy. The discovery of the Higgs boson has been a monumental one because this particle is very special. Very different from the other 16 elementary particles that we had discovered and measured before. It got very special quantum numbers, or very special properties. It's related to a new type of interaction. It's related to the most obscure and problematic sector of the standard model, which is the theory that describes the elementary particles and their interaction. So it's a unique door into new physics. It's a unique tool that we have to look for physics beyond the standard model, the physics that could help us elucidate other mysteries. So that was a great achievement, but also the precise measurement of the Higgs boson and many other well-known particles, which has allowed us to make step forward in our understanding of fundamental physics. We didn't discover new physics. This may appear as disappointing, but of course discovering new particles is always very glamorous and very exciting. But on the other hand, also being able to disprove some scenarios, to falsify null hypotheses, is very, very important to help us direct our thoughts, our theoretical thoughts, and our exploration toward the most promising directions.
That kind of breaks a very successful paradigm that particle physics has had in the past decades of theorists propose a model that involves particles and experimentalists find those particles, and CERN has played a great role in that. And it's not happened this time. Surely, is that a problem?
It has not always been like that in the history of particle physics. There have been times where theory has been guiding the experiments, and there have been times where the experiments have been discovering a plethora of new particles, and then the theory is trying to make sense of them. So now we are in a time where perhaps more than ever we need to make progress on the experimental side to give some hints also to theorists about the most promising direction for thoughts and for developments of new ideas.
Mm-hmm. There are very established theoretical ideas such as supersymmetry, for example, that proposes this bevy of particles, one for each of the standard model particles we know, and there's been no sign of them at the LHC. Does that mean something like supersymmetry is not a viable option?
So we have to be very careful about it. I personally consider supersymmetry a very nice theory. The fact that we didn't find any sign of supersymmetry as yet can indicate two things. One, supersymmetry is wrong. Okay, fine. So that's one. Or that supersymmetry sits at an energy scale that is above the energy scales that we are exploring now. Or that it manifests itself through particles that are extremely light, extremely weakly interacting, which is also a little bit of a weird scenario, let's say like that. The goal of our work is not to run behind a given theory. Of course, theories are very important for us to optimize our detectors, our instruments, to develop our analysis techniques are very good benchmarks. But nature may have chosen a completely different way. So what we have to do is to address the open questions, and there are many, many of them related to the Higgs boson, its mass, and many others. The problem of dark matter, the problem of matter-antimatter asymmetry. So these are the, and many others. These are the questions that we have to address.
You mentioned dark matter. Of course, this vast quantity of matter, so different from the normal matter that we've characterized at experiments like the LHC, and yet we have no idea what it is. We can't find the particles that make up dark matter. Why do you think that is? Where is it hiding?
Well, it can be, you know, dark matter to be compatible with the evolution and the structure of the universe can be extremely light and extremely heavy. So it may well be that the window that we have explored so far is not large enough. I don't know if dark matter is of the dark matter particle and the type of interaction and mass that is accessible, will be accessible to the LHC or to future collider. Perhaps not. But clearly, colliders are one of the most important tools that we have today to explore dark matter, not the only one.
Is fundamental physics in a bit of a funk, trying to think too much about established theories and not about new ideas?
I think you are correct. I think we have to address our research and our exploration with a very open mind. That's why the Large Hadron Collider experiments have been built. In particular, the two general purpose, ATLAS and CMS, in a way that, in principle, will allow them to detect any type of new particles. We are not running behind the particular scenarios. We have to be very, very open to be able to address the open question in the most, you know, in the most powerful way.
CERN is already looking to the future and how we validate theory, and it recently published its plans for the future circular collider, which is like the LHC but even bigger, with a price tag of I think 20 billion or so. What convinces you that more of the same but bigger is the way forward for particle physics?
So first of all, CERN at the moment is studying at the level of design study and at the level of R&D for accelerated development of new technologies, two projects. One is a linear collider called CLIC, Compact Linear Collider, which will smash electrons against positrons, or linear collider coming from the two opposite ends of the arms. And the other one is the Large Hadron Collider, Future Circular Collider, which is a ring as the Large Hadron Collider, but three times bigger. It's bigger, but also with much sophisticated and powerful technologies that will allow us to make a big step in energy, or a big step in intensity of the beams, or in the possibility of understanding how fundamental physics works. So it's not just size. It's size and new technologies.
And what's the benefit of going to higher energies?
If you want to understand the properties of this very special particle in all details, you need to, understanding also possible rare decays or rare phenomena, you need to have a large production of Higgs boson. So that's one of the reasons. But also because when you go to higher energy, of course, you can produce heavy particles which have not been observed so far, maybe because they are too heavy to be produced at the Large Hadron Collider. The Higgs boson has only been discovered at the LHC and not at previous colliders, because only the LHC had enough energy to produce it with enough rate. And so that can be discovered and visible. So energies and intensity, but especially energies, help.
There are some theoretical models that say, well, there just aren't any particles at a energy scale we can realistically reach, even with any future collider. So isn't it taking a big gamble to build something that big to find new particles?
What is the goal of particle physics, in particular of accelerators and colliders? easy to discover new particles or to make step forward in our understanding of fundamental physics. The LHC collider, which was the predecessor of the Large Hadron Collider, didn't discover any single particle. And yet there are few projects in the history of particle physics that have allowed us to make so big project in our understanding of how the fundamental interaction works. So the goal of any scientific exploration is to make progress in our understanding of nature. Discovering new particle is a way, but also very, very precise measurement of known particles that allow us in an indirect way to understand where the scale of new physics is are as important. Ruling out scenarios that are unfounded is also as important to redirect our thoughts toward radical changes sometimes and more promising directions. So I think we have to propose tools that allow us to make step forward.
What would you say to people who say, oh, it's not worth spending that amount of money on particle physics, we should be spending it on, say, mitigating climate change?
We should be spending money also in mitigating climate change. One does not exclude the other one. You know, I think that it is the duty and the right of humanity to understand how nature works, how the universe evolved, how the universe will evolve in the future. Pushing back the limits of knowledge is an aspiration, a duty, a right of humanity since human beings started populating our planet. Science is a driver of innovation because very often the goals of us scientists are so pushed, are so ambitious, that they require the development of technologies which will go well beyond what society, industry knows at that moment in time. And so, you know, the spin-off are huge, are immense. The World Wide Web, medical applications, and many, many others. So that's also the important role of science, of really driving the technologies. In a world which is fractured, with many strengths pulling apart rather than, you know, working together, science in general is still a good example of what humanity can do when we use our cultural diversity to work together and to do something good and to, you know, to push good values.
You talk about this fractious period of international politics when those established structures are increasingly questioned or are under strain. Can science actually prosper in this? Or what does it need to do to prosper in this era or counter those?
I think science is a good example and a good message of peace and of collaboration at a very delicate time. As the arts, and perhaps even more than the arts, brings together people from all over the world, because science is based on facts and not on opinions. And the laws of nature are the same here in the UK, in the US, in China. So nobody can argue about facts. And so this is a very, very strong glue. A very strong glue because it's something that unifies people of all culture, tradition, passport, religion, political belief. So science can really play this role.
Last year, CERN entered the headlines for all the wrong reasons, when the theorist Alessandro Strumia made comments about the role of men and women in physics. How did that feel to be at the head of an organisation in the headlines for that reason?
I think that case was an opportunity for us to re-emphasise the importance of diversity in all its facets. In that case, we were talking about gender diversity, but it's not just gender, it's geographical diversity, diversity in terms of ethnicity, etc. Diversity means giving everyone the same opportunities, and unfortunately in our world this is not true. We still have gaps between in terms of gender, but also in terms of, you know, developed countries, developing countries, the rich and the poor. We live in a world where technology is expanding at a very fast pace, and this fast-growing and fast-expanding technology brings the risk of exacerbating the differences between, again, the rich and the poor, those who have access to the technologies and those who don't.
And what can an organization like CERN do in practical terms?
So in practical terms, what we are doing is to promote support, expand open science. What we do, what we publish, what we develop is open to everybody. Already in 1993, the web was made available to everyone, for everyone to use and develop, royalty free. And this is still true today. We develop open source software, open hardware. We publish our results on, in open access journals, available to everyone without paying, for free. Our data are, once they are understood and well well calibrated and debugged, they are available to people. So this is one important component, open science. The other important component is education, outreach, training available to everybody. So we have many initiatives, for instance, summer student program for non-member state countries, a fraction of which are, you know, students coming from less privileged countries, education accessible to all, reaching out countries that are not really at the forefront of science and technology through the participation of their scientists in CERN activities. We have international cooperation agreement with those countries. So we try in our little corner to do something.
Mm-hmm. So what achievement are you most proud of both at your time at CERN and in your career, and indeed of CERN as an organization?
From the point of view of my scientific career, of course, I had the fortune to be involved right from the beginning in the Large Hadron Collider, in the framework of the ATLAS experiment, and in particular in developing the detector, the analysis technique, that then, and then being on the forefront at the time of the discovery of the Higgs boson. And that was for clearly a great satisfaction. Well, I've been lucky enough to grow in this lab. I came here as a young postdoc, and of course I learned a lot, not only in terms of physics, but also, you know, I grew here as a human being. I think it has been very helpful for me to be in this environment, to develop myself as an open and tolerant person. So I am very, very grateful to this very special organization for what I got, not only as a physicist, of course, but also as a human being. I think the atmosphere of this place is very special. It's that there are a few places like this one in the world, but not so many, and we should cherish them because the world definitely and desperately need them.